Hi everyone and welcome back to Splash Page. I'm Sean and as always I'm joined by Andrew and we're back now, fully up and running.
We are back. Have
our new show to review, Why the Last Man, that is airing on FX on Hulu. So it sounds very confusing, but it's just on Hulu. I think for me, this is a comic I loved. I probably read 5 or 7 years ago. It's a quick 60 issue run. And by Brian K. Vaughan, who is one of the absolute legends. And this is a story that is based around the idea of what happens if every single mammal with a Y chromosome dropped dead instantly.
Yeah, it's an intense premise.
Absolutely, yeah. It's not exactly, light reading. But the thing about it, and this is the thing about every comic book show coming out right now, is it was written in its own time, in its own era. The early kind of 2000s. And now obviously it's being remade today, so they're making a bunch of updates, as they would anyways, to make a comic work better in a TV setting.
Yeah.
But we'll go over a lot of the changes, why we think they made some of those changes, and some we're just not going to touch because some of them just aren't relevant to the plot and being a great show and a great story. So let's jump in, Weens.
Let's rock.
Rather than just telling the story linearly, we kind of get a first episode that gives us a sense of the world that we now live in, as well as what was happening to get us to that point. And that is something that really wasn't in the comics. Yeah. The comics start with a handful of panels of the world as is, and then every male drops dead.
Yeah.
Here we see that there was a lot of tension in government and in the White House, and we see what Hero's life was like before everyone died.
We do get a lot more of the background on Hero that we did not get in the books, at least not up front. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's super dark. We know a lot happens with Hero just based on us both having read the comics, and I still fully suspect those things will happen, or expect them to happen, but this whole start with her kind of dating, I think his name was Mike, and attempting to get him to leave his wife for her, and then it gets physical in not a good way, and we see Hero actually kills Mike just before all of the men in the world die.
Yeah, that might have been the last murder of a man in this world.
Potentially, yeah. And we know that's going to come back. There's no reason to film that scene if it was going to be irrelevant to who the character is or what happens to the character later.
There's got
to
be some held over guilt there.
1,000%. Yeah. We also get introduced to the title's namesake, Y, York.
Yeah.
In a pretty similar way that we kind of meet him. In the comic, we find out that he is an escape
artist.
We find out that he's an escape artist.
Yep.
And, in the TV show, we see him teaching a little kid magic. And I think in the comic, he's just attempting to get out of an upside down straight jacket by himself.
I think he was on the phone with Beth at the time.
Right, who at this point was already in Australia.
Yes.
As opposed to this whole conversation about her wanting to go to Australia or her going to Australia.
Right.
So that's an interesting change. It does have a bit more rationale behind why York would feel kind of a bit more abandoned, because they do have that discussion that does kind of sound like they're going to break up.
And it does introduce us to Beth, which we don't really get early on in the comics either. We just know that there's a Beth somewhere on the other side of the world that he wants to get to, but we don't really know who she is or what their relationship was like.
But we do know that he wanted to propose.
Yes.
So we know that they're dating. Yes. We just don't have any interaction besides that one phone
with
call.
With the person, yeah.
I think the other great thing about the introduction to Yurik is he's walking around with his gas mask on and an ampersand. And this, totally war-torn New York City. And, the second the scene showed the helicopter kind of leaning over the edge. Yeah. I don't know what you thought, Weens, but that was like a, you know, Chekhov's helicopter, in my opinion. You know, you knew that thing was falling. It was too precariously positioned, and they spent too much time on it. So as soon as I saw that, I was like, that thing's going to fall and like barely miss them. And sure enough, that's what happened.
Honestly, you called it. When I saw that helicopter, my first thought was, that's some really cool CGI. That was a good idea. I like that. I assume they didn't put a helicopter on the roof of the building. I assume that maybe they did. I don't know. But
yeah, I doubt they would.
But my first thought was, that's a cool idea to have a, oh, okay.
Yeah. We then meet Jennifer Brown, who is in the comic a member of the House of Representatives for Ohio. It seems like they went a different direction. I can't remember exactly the title they gave her, but due to the line of succession, she becomes president based on what they believe is, you know, who still
right.
exists, who's still alive.
Right. Well, she got promoted to Speaker of the House and then to president within an hour, I think was the right. storyline there.
And it's because two women who were above her in the chain of command, the first one was not born in the United States, which is one of the rules about being yep. a president, and the second one mysteriously disappeared and is assumed dead. Right. And we find out there in episode 3 that woman has survived.
She is in Israel, somehow survived the crashing of a building, and is in an Israeli medical tent. Barely able to speak, but she's definitely alive.
Yeah, so that obviously will be most likely a big plot point coming up.
Yeah.
Also, just want to mention 355, who is another fantastic, fantastic character from this comic, and I think the casting was excellent. We see her in what kind of looks like almost a meth crack house,
yeah.
building a bomb. They call her Jade, and it's just a really weird, uncomfortable scene until you kind of put two and two together that she's jumping out of the window and running away. And then, boom.
Yeah.
So she was obviously sent there on a mission to take out whoever was attempting to buy that bomb. And she did so rather successfully.
Yeah, seems to work out. I like when she was climbing out the window, because for a second I wasn't sure what was going on. I'm like, oh, I guess she's just going for a run. Oh. Everything in this show surprised me, and in retrospect, I should have seen it all coming.
Right. Yeah.
I've read the books. I should have seen all, but...
Right. Yeah. She goes back to her, like, little shitty house and... bleaches the hell mm-hmm. out of everything and makes it like she was never there before she gets called onto an assignment to be part of this Secret Service
yeah.
for the President of the United States. You know, outside of just meeting the character who she worked with, we don't really know what that mission was. We just knew there was a semi-credible threat against the President's
yeah.
life, and they wanted to make sure they had one of their best agents, Agent 355, on the case.
Well, that also surprised me, because how do they not just tell her what the mission is? But I get it, for dramatic purposes, they don't want us to know, but she should have known. You can't just send someone into a thing and not tell them what they're doing there.
Yeah, she does say she hadn't been briefed
yeah.
yet. Because it was her, quote-unquote, first day on the job, the day that it all happened.
I think they'd brief her before she showed up if there was a credible threat. But that's just my opinion.
Right.
I don't know how these kind of secret society rings normally work.
Next, let's talk about a character named Kimber, who
yeah.
is the president's daughter and author who wrote Boy Mom, a little the demasculation of men and whatnot.
Which, oddly, men do demasculate pretty quickly in this, as in they disappear.
Yeah.
It's about the, as far down as you can go.
right. yeah, her character... is pretty similar to what I remember from the comics, where a lot of the wives of different senators and pieces of the government kind of demand the respect and the placement that their significant others held. So
right.
we're definitely seeing kind of coming to the head of the, for the lack of a better term, Republicans and Democrats that are remaining in this world. And this is definitely going to be something that boils over at some point if
yeah.
you consider what has happened already not boiling over.
Well, that's going to be our main opposition, or at least one of our main oppositions. And that kind of makes sense, because a president's wife or a politician's wife is usually political in and of themselves. And then all of a sudden that politician disappears and the other side takes control just because of who died. I could see where some of that anger might even come from, kind of being left out of the loop solely because there were more women on one side of the aisle than on the other.
Right. Yeah. And then another character who I don't believe is in the comic, but it may be kind of a character created for the show that takes a few pieces from other characters.
That's what I'm thinking.
And her name is Nora, and she is kind of like a press secretary or something along those lines for the president.
Mm-hmm.
We get introduced to her. She's kind of in a field and the president's shooting a gun. She gets to shoot a gun for the first time in her life, which I'm going to assume is not the last time she shoots a gun. She kind of has a really rough go of it for a number of reasons. I mean, obviously everyone lost somebody, but she loses her husband and her son.
Yeah.
And then is completely left high and dry by the powers that be that now run the government.
Yeah, she and is her not her daughter, necessary.
Yeah, not essential by any That's means, the word. Apparently. And, her and her daughter kind of get left out on their own. It looks like they get together with a bunch of other women and children first, and then are told they have too many mouths to feed, so they kind of kick them out.
Yeah.
We see her daughter is extremely unathletic because she just falls and cuts herself. Like, she's just running. She didn't jump or anything.
Yeah. I mean, there was anger and sadness in that moment, too, but also, sure, unathletic.
So that woman is coming back. She is going to be, I would assume, another antagonist for our main group of heroes.
Yeah, here. That'll probably be a side opposition that builds over time.
Yeah, I could see her starting.
If she belongs where I think she does and what characters she may or may not be,
right,
it'll probably come up in a little bit.
I think so too.
Well, that's the thing about this show. Yeah, we jump back and forth when episode one first started in time, and then we kind of jump forward in time, like 8 days, 63 days, whatever it was. But also, this whole show has kind of jumped back in time from the start of the comic book and really tried to set up a lot of the politics and a lot of the players before the book started, which makes sense dramatically because it'd be hard to just jump in to a post-apocalyptic world and care about any of these people if we didn't know them at least a little bit before.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah, so really episode one sets up this world, introduces us to a few characters, but it doesn't really drive too much of the plot or really give you a great indication of kind of what's to come. But luckily, Hulu released two additional episodes. So, Weens, why don't you give us a quick rundown of what happened in episode two?
Yeah, so episode two picks up right where episode one left off, in the middle of the presidential meeting where all the men in the world drop dead, everyone with a Y chromosome. And we see 355 kind of starting to take control and figure out what's going on. And we see Jennifer Brown start to take control, and that's where she really steps up her game and takes on the kind of role of a leader.
Mm-hmm.
For a while, we start following Agent 355. She's off on a mission of some sort. She's looking for answers, clues. She finds an address. You have that address?
Yeah, not going to say the street, but it was Winthrop, Mass. So it was in Massachusetts.
Right.
And the envelope said, what did it say, not yet?
Not yet.
This is when 355 goes to what I can only assume is some like secret hideout for
the Culper Ring,
because she does a few other spy-ish things in there, and she actually opens a P.O. box that was P.O. box number 355, I think, to get into the room itself. So, unfortunately, the rest of the team, it appears, at least all the males with Y chromosomes, are dead in that room. And she starts going through some stuff and finds that letter.
Yeah, which eventually, we think, leads her to Dr. Mann, the geneticist that we come across later in the episode.
Yeah, and in episode three as well, they really drive home this point. We know Dr. Mann is in Boston, obviously, Massachusetts. But it really is 355 who is pushing Jennifer Brown and team to utilize Dr. Mann as opposed to the other names that were on the list. And 355's rationale is around the fact that she was doing everything for science and not doing it for political sway, so she's really the right person to help do this. But it appears, at least based on us taking this guess with this little piece of information, that this is a larger thing and really driven by 355 or by the Culper Ring.
Right. She makes some really persuasive arguments for Dr. Mann. Let's see if that works out. So also episode two, as happens in, it seems, every television show and movie, New York is falling apart. We're going to lose New York. The generators.
What else is new, right?
Yeah, the generators won't turn on. We're losing power. The woman that ran the generators isn't, she left to go spend some time with herself. And the water's rising, it's all stagnant, it's filled with dead bodies.
Yeah, and a couple things happen in this scene that I really like. The first one is there's that spray painted, there's dead people down here, which I think is probably a nod to The Walking Dead.
Oh.
Which is, obviously another huge show, and Dead Inside, I think, was the sign in that one. Mm. Yorick also loses ampersand for a few minutes there, goes into that mucky, terrible water. And we've seen, based on the rain that New York has gotten over the last 2 months, that some people are willing to actually walk through that water.
Absolutely.
In the subway.
If
I'm assuming you are not one of those people.
No, I did not walk through the water in the subway. I stood out in the rain for a half an hour to catch a cab, but I did not walk through the water in the subway.
Yeah, not going to do that. Not
and if this show had come out a year ago, I would have said, well, that's crazy looking sci-fi, but they might have just filmed it during the last hurricane.
Yeah, that's very true.